By the end of the 1930s, it was very clear that Hitler was preparing for war. Let's take a few minutes in this brief lecture to go over much of the geopolitical material that relates to the invasion of Poland, which was jointly executed by Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union. So, moving through the late 1930s, we see that Hitler is increasingly advancing greater and greater territorial demands on Europe. And in a policy that has been widely criticized ever since, the Allies generally give in to Hitler's demands. He throws a tantrum, and the Allies allow him to take some additional territory, and it seems that nothing is ever enough for Adolf Hitler. Three areas in particular are important for our purposes. First of all, there was the remilitarization of the Rhineland region. This was a region that was, after World War I, declared a military-free zone for Nazi Germany, and Hitler simply defied that order by moving his troops into the Rhineland, which was much more symbolic than anything else, but it was a dramatic assertion of Nazi power at the time. And secondly, the very important Anschluss. This refers to the joining of Austria to Germany. We should note that Austria and Germany are very related cultures. Austria, although they are separate countries, Austria, of course, speaks the German language. And with Hitler's greater successes throughout the 1930s, many Austrians felt that they should hitch their wagon to Hitler's, and in fact this was achieved through this Anschluss in 1938. If you've ever seen the film The Sound of Music, that's a very important dramatization of the period of the Anschluss. And then finally, and in the prelude to war itself, the capture of the Sudetenland. This is a mountainous region surrounding the edge of Czechoslovakia. There are a lot of ethnic Germans living there, and Hitler claimed that they wanted to be reunited with Germany proper. And he essentially demanded that Czechoslovakia surrender these territories, and the Allies simply could not back up Czechoslovakia's demands to retain their territorial integrity. In particular, there is one of the most infamous moments in 20th century history, diplomatic history, when Neville Chamberlain of England goes to Munich to discuss the Sudetenland with Hitler, and he returns, and when he lands on the tarmac back in England, there's a crowd of people around him. You'd actually watch this speech on YouTube, where he proudly portrays this letter that Hitler signed that agrees that he will not advance on any other country once he gets the Sudetenland from Czechoslovakia. And Chamberlain famously proclaims that he has achieved peace in our times. This was, of course, famous last words, because Hitler would soon go on to attack Poland. The attack on Poland could not happen without an agreement in advance with Joseph Stalin of the Soviet Union. Let us recall, as you can see in this map here, that Germany is located in the center of Europe. And one of the great military risks for Germany is that it cannot fight a two-front war. That is, it cannot easily engage with forces to its west and to its east simultaneously, at least not for very long. The logistics of the supply chains, of moving reinforcements back and forth, of maintaining two very distinct fronts simultaneously, is simply too much for Germany. And so what Hitler resolved to do was to first pacify his eastern front through a treaty with Joseph Stalin. And once that treaty was fully engaged, then he would turn his attention to the west and he would invade France. And that's in fact exactly what he did. In a secret pact that was signed by the foreign ministers of both countries, the so-called Molotov-Ribbentrop Soviet-Nazi Non-Aggression Pact basically said that Germany and the Soviet Union promised not to attack each other in case of the eruption of hostilities elsewhere. Now, Hitler would later go on to double-cross Stalin and would attack the Soviet Union once he had pacified the West. This is in 1941, 2 years after the Nazi-Soviet pact was signed. But for the time being, the region was safe for Hitler because Stalin accepted the treaty. Now, What was in it for Stalin to accept this treaty? Basically, Hitler put Poland and the Baltic countries on the table. If you look closely at this map, you'll see that Germany and the USSR were separated by several countries, notably Poland here in yellow, and then Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia, the so-called Baltic countries. Now, all of these regions were actually part of the Russian Empire before 1917, when the Russian Empire collapsed in two revolutions, one immediately after the other, resulting in the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics to the east, and these four new countries, Poland, Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia, being created in their wake. Other countries were also created. We talked about that in a couple of lectures ago. And so the Soviets wanted back at least some of that territory, and Hitler made a deal that if Stalin would agree to a non-aggression pact, then Germany would invade from the west, and the Soviet Union could invade from the east, and then simply claim the territories. And in fact, that is exactly what they did. Shortly after this secret pact was signed, of course it leaked out and now we know all about it, this is what the map of Europe looked like. You can see that Germany on the left acquires this large kind of brownish area, which are labeled here as German annexations. There's going to be a little bit more complications of this. We'll see in one more map in a second. But the bright green, the kind of fluorescent green area, was acquired by the Soviet Union. And Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, which had just received their independence after World War I, now had it rudely taken away from them. They did establish kind of puppet regimes. There was the Soviet Socialist Republic of Lithuania, but they were clearly dominated by Moscow. Similarly, Poland was divided in half, with the western region going to Germany and the eastern region going to the Soviet Union. We'll have a lot to say about the Jews living in these territories over the next many lectures. To look at this in just a little bit more detail, however, this map here is a little bit simplified. Here's one that shows that there were some adjustments to the map over the course of 1939 to 1940. This had very major implications for people who found themselves, for example, in Lithuania. This is especially relevant for institutions like the Mir Yeshiva. So if you have a look on the left, you see what the border looked like in 1939. You can see the red region are the Russian and Ukrainian and Belarusian Soviet Socialist Republics. And then taken over were the regions of Eastern Poland, Latvia, Estonia, and Finland. But then after some negotiations, you can see on the right, these boundaries were adjusted ever so slightly after 1940. So what this means is that the region that was most heavily populated by Jews, Poland, which had over 3 million Jews, and also very large populations in Lithuania, somewhat less in Latvia, and very few in Estonia, were taken into two distinct geopolitical spheres during the years 1939 to 1941. More specifically, September 1939 with the invasion of Poland, to June of 1941 with something called Operation Barbarossa, when Hitler would double-cross the Soviets, and we'll come to that. But that means that for the next 2 years, Jews in this region had one of two very different realities of experience. There were those Jews who found themselves within the German orbit, and we'll speak about those shortly, and then there were those Jews who found themselves within the Soviet orbit. And that's what we're going to address in the next class, which will look at specifically what happened to those Jews who found themselves new citizens of Soviet republics between 1939 and 1941. Thank you very much for watching.